Well, thank you very much, and good morning, comrades. It's great to be here, and to especially to follow my very good friend Cat Smith and wonderful words. I think we're coming to the end of what I call an anti-socialist revolution, which really began in the 1970s, and we are starting now, I think, to build the counter-revolution, to restart, to rebuild democratic socialism. I think there's a massive thirst for change as well. It's not just in Britain, because we've got Jeremy now, which is a wonderful thing. I can hardly believe it. 2 years ago, we sat on the back benches together thinking, wouldn't it be great to have a left Labour government and be, you know, Jeremy's leader. I mean, it just really is incredible. And, I cannot say how happy I am every day when I wake up and realise that Jeremy's the leader of that party. But it's not just in Britain, I think there are changes elsewhere. And Bernie Sanders almost became the Democratic candidate for the Democrat Party in America, and he openly calls himself a socialist. And had he been fighting against the dreadful Republican candidate, I won't mention his name, I think we'd have been seeing possibly a socialist president in America, which would have been something equally wonderful. But this anti-socialist revolution, economic philosophy called neoliberalism, which came about inspired by a mad philosopher called Friedrich von Hayek, who believed that the state, having the state involved in our lives, was the road to serfdom. He wrote a book which we thought was a joke when I was studying economics in the 1960s, but sadly somebody took it very seriously and carried it around as a Bible, and she was called Margaret Thatcher. And on the day she was elected, Friedrich von Hayek was an old man then, he said it was the greatest day of his life. Well, that's where it really began in earnest. And within days, she'd abolished exchange controls and began the process of moving towards the world of globalization, privatization, liberalization, neoliberalism, a world where markets dominate and democratic power is diminished. It's about destroying the role of the state in society, making an elective democracy where we choose how we're governed and what we do with our lives, and handing power to markets and to global capitalism, making governments mere decoration, and the real power is with markets. We've got to reverse that. I think we are now starting to see a reversal of that as well. But austerity is all part of that philosophy. Cutting the state funding, they say it has to be done because we can't afford things. That's complete nonsense. It's not true. What they really want to do is to diminish the role of the state, and even New Labour, sadly, followed that philosophy as well. Gordon Brown was desperate to get public spending as part of the economy down below 40%, because the argument was that these economies couldn't be run. They just wouldn't work if we had high public spending and a high proportion of the economy in state hands. Well, actually, at the same time, one of the most successful economies in the world at that time was Sweden, where 56% of the economy was in public hands, in public spending. And it just demonstrates what complete nonsense that was. And indeed, if you look at the book, The Spirit Level, those societies where you've got a very large state and a high degree of redistribution and heavy public spending and no austerity, actually the social ills are much less than in those countries where you've got a big gap between the rich and poor and a high proportion of public ownership. You've got one end of that scale. Those of you who've read the book, you've seen the graphs. At one end of every graph is America, with us moving in that direction. At the other end, you've got the Scandinavian countries. And if you want a civilized society, you've got to have a heavy involvement of the state in our lives, where we pay significant taxes, and in return we get a wonderful health service, great education, housing, and so on. But this deficit in public finances is complete nonsense. If 1945, after a war, naturally, a lot of public spending, a massive government debt, but the Labour government at that time, it ran a world of full employment, relatively high public spending, high taxation, and the government debt dropped like a stone. And it was much higher than it is now. And the idea that we've got a crisis because of a deficit is complete and total nonsense. It is not true. And there is historical examples to show that it's not true. So we don't have a spending problem. And we should be, I think, starting to spend a lot more. but it means we've got to collect the taxes that are owed. £120 billion worth of taxes which are either avoided or evaded. Richard Murphy's book and his figures have not been challenged by government, and I'm one of those who raises it constantly in Parliament. And then even the Tories never come back to me and say, oh, it's not true. They will admit there's maybe £40 billion or something like that that isn't collected, but they won't accept the £120 billion figure, but they've never demonstrated that it's not true. So we're not after we've collected the taxes, we want to then, I think, high tax rates. Some 10 years ago, I was speaking in a budget debate on a dull Thursday afternoon in the chamber. You know, we had these long debates after the budget, and you know, you can get your words in, if you, especially on Thursday, which is usually a time when not many members are about. And I suggested, well, if we want to raise money, we should just raise income tax proportionally on the rich, of course, not on the less well off. So I suggested a system where we have, for those on 60,000 a year individual income, that they should pay a tax rate of 50%. Those on 100,000 should pay 60%, and those on 200,000 pay 70%, only on the income above those levels, of course. And, you know, nobody took any notice, but the Deputy Speaker, Sylvia Heal, very nice person, afterwards she said, Kelvin, I do so agree with you. Why doesn't the government just do what you say? Well, I wish, you know. But you know, the reality is, in the late 1970s, when there was an economic problem, we had a Labour government, and the tax rates were much higher than that. The top marginal rate of income under Dennis Healey was 83%, and there was a 15% surcharge above that on unearned income. So some people at the top part of their income were paying 98%. I don't think there's anything particularly wrong with that, and I think we ought to just collect the money. But we don't necessarily need to go back to Dennis's time when he said we want to squeeze the rich until the pips squeak. But, you know, we could certainly have higher tax rates even after we've collected all the tax which is owed anyway. So there isn't a problem. But we are still dominated, I think, to an extent by the macroeconomic right. And it's interesting that on the debate on Thursday, I took part in the debate on industrial strategy. Even those terms, industrial strategy, sounds very left-wing and interventionist. And it's very interesting that some of the right-wing neoliberal free marketeers on the Tory benches were very twitchy about the fact that this was being moved by a Tory MP, who clearly was moving towards, you know, not the left, but certainly away from the neoliberal right. And I think the Tory party is going to be seriously divided over these things, I'm glad to say. But you know, we should argue the case confidently for a socialist interventionist world where we manage the world on behalf of working class people and we actually start to spend money again. And where will we spend the money? Well, let's talk about health, the health service. We spend approximately 2.5% less of our GDP on health than the Germans, the French, the Dutch and whatever. 2.5% of GDP is about £42 billion. If we had an extra £42 billion on the health service every single year, there wouldn't be any problems in the health service, would there? We just don't spend enough on it. We've got to spend more. And that's part of austerity, part of the Tories and the right, the neoliberal right, trying to squeeze the life out of public services. At the same time, of course, they're privatising bits of it, which cost much more. If you look at private health services, like in America, they cost a lot more to put on than a very efficient public sector health services like the National Health Service. So the health service works miracles on the money they get, but they need more money, and we should spend more money. Local government services, Kat has said, needs more money as well. I mean, they're desperately being squeezed, and even, as Kat has said, Tory councillors now are starting to understand that their government is destroying the public services which they're trying to run. On care, you know, free care for the elderly. I mean, we are still being forced, working class people now, being forced to sell our houses to pay for care for granny when she goes into care. Why don't we just have a public care system exactly like the National Health Service, which is paid for out of taxation, and we tax to pay for it for everybody. So it's fair, because the great thing about income tax, it is proportional. And it is progressive, that the rich pay most and the poor pay least, or sometimes nothing, and that's fair enough. But we all get equal service when we are elderly. I have to say that my own local council some years ago was forced to privatise all its care homes. We had several care homes in my constituency which were absolutely wonderful. The residents liked them, the staff lived in the local community, they were trade union organised. The medical professionals all thought they were wonderful. And the last one to close, we had a kind of wake, if you like, about the closure. And we had health service professionals and the staff and the residents and local people all saying this was wrong. And it was sadly a Labour government, a Labour council that was doing it, being forced by central government. So, and then of course we've got public ownership. Well, public ownership is actually a very efficient way of running things. And you look at the railways. I mean, if we brought the railways back into public ownership, we'd save a lot of money. When the East Coast Main Line was spent 5 years in public ownership because the privateers had walked away, it actually delivered £1 billion to the Treasury. Now, that £1 billion would have gone into private pockets for a less good service. So public ownership works. Energy, water, and I think PFI. I would like to see PFI abandoned. We could give, you know, swap. Costing the health service a fortune. Very simple way of doing that is what they did after the Second World War, public ownership. We exchange government stock, low interest bearing government stock, and we take it back into public ownership. Abandoning PFI would save vast sums of money. But I think the biggest crisis of all is actually with housing at the moment. And the sale of council houses, the destruction of public centre housing has caused, I think, misery for millions. And we've got to, I think, to reverse that. I'd like to see a wide-scale programme of municipalisation, bringing a lot of private rented houses back into public ownership. Bringing those up to decent standards. We just had reports this week about the vast numbers, millions of houses which are not fit for habitation, bringing them up to proper standards. And I have to say that in my constituency, we've got some wonderful council houses, former council houses, which are now 50 or 60 years old. They look like new. They are perfect houses, brilliantly built. We could afford to build those 60 years ago, and somehow we can't afford to do it now. Well, it's just not true. Like so much, which is said by those who believe in austerity, those who believe in cuts, those who believe in squeezing the life out of the public sector and cutting taxes for the rich. We've got to oppose those. We've got to, I think, build this socialist counter-revolution and starting with the election of Jeremy as the next Prime Minister. Thank you.